Get the career you want with the skills employers need. Make a BTEC work for you.
Welcome to the Skills World Live radio show, sponsored by OneFile, a world where everyone is learning for their future. Stay tuned for all the news, views and interviews in association with FE News.
Hello and welcome to another very special edition of Skills World Live. On the programme today, we're talking to the minister who leads and sets the publicly funded skills agenda in England. And at the end of the show, we'll hear from the man who wants to replace him and his government at the next general election. The Skills and Apprenticeships Minister I'm referring to is Alex Burghardt MP, the 13th elected politician, no less, to do the job at Sanctuary Buildings SW1 since 1997, when the new government post at the then Department for Education and Employment was first created by the Labour government. The post has also been abolished twice, only to be reinstated. Man marking the minister in the House of Commons is Toby Perkins MP, or formerly known as Her Majesty's Shadow Minister for Skills and Further Education. He'll be telling me all about Labour's alternative vision at the end of the programme. But first, let's hear from Alex Burghardt. I was invited by the DfE's press team recently to conduct the interview in a bustling headquarters right in the heart of Whitehall, where it appears civil servants had clearly got the Jacob Rees-Mogg memo. You know, the one about getting off Zoom in your pyjamas and back to the office. Coming up next, after this short break, is part one of my head-to-head with the Skills Minister and former academic historian. You might be surprised to know we began our examination of Anglo-Saxon skills policy somewhere back in the 5th century AD.
You're listening to the Skills World Live radio show with Tom Buick.
Minister Burghardt, thanks so much for taking the time to appear on my podcast broadcast by FE News. It's great to see you today. Now, you've been in the role now for about 6 months. There'll be many in the sector who know you well. You've been out visiting, I know, lots of FE colleges and other providers. But just tell us a bit about this journey from history lecturer with a PhD in Mercian history to now being our skills minister.
Well, thanks, Tom. Thanks for having me on. Yeah, I think it's been 8 months now. I know.
8 months.
I came in the middle of September, and I was very... I was really pleased to get the call from the Prime Minister because I worked in DfE, worked in this building where we are now, in Sanctuary Buildings, twice before. Once as an expert advisor on the Munro Review of Child Protection back in 2010. And then once when I worked for the Office of the Children's Commissioner, then Anne Longfield, in 2016. So I'd always sort of hoped that in my MP's life I'd end up back in here, because education's been a big part of my life all the way through. Both of my parents were teachers, state school teachers. My dad was head teacher of middle school in Southampton, and my mum was a maths teacher in Dorset. And then, as you say, after I finished my undergraduate, I did a bit of school teaching, but then I went back to university and did a doctorate in the formation of the state in early medieval England, which is a very, very important subject.
Yeah, very relevant probably to today's conversation in some ways.
Everyone thinks I'm joking when I say how relevant medieval history is to modern history. I think in a lot of ways we're living in a medieval time, that a lot of old assumptions that have been around for a great deal of time have started to shift, some for the better, some for the worse. And that's quite reflective of what was happening at the end of the Roman Empire, the sort of transformation of post-Roman Europe, where things that had been stuck in the same place for centuries were suddenly overturned. And if you think of Roman Britain, where for 400 years people lived in cities, they used currency, many people spoke Latin. By the end of the Roman period, they were Christian, they built in stone. And within 100 years, all of those things had gone. It was the most fundamental change in living circumstances to take place in many societies, but certainly in Britain. But out of that emerged Anglo-Saxon England, which created many of the institutions that we still live with today.
Okay, well, we'll skip over the Middle Ages and the Enlightenment period and then obviously the modern democratic age, but I'm sure as I go through this interview there might be some reference back to the formation of the English state and what that means now in terms of your skills brief. And perhaps then more recent history, or feels to me like ancient history, given I was in the department here 20 years ago as a skills advisor. Actually, Priti Patel, the name that many will know as the current Home Secretary, she was my deputy working on post-16 sector skills implementation. I mean, just as a professional that's got also skills and education in my blood, you know, quarter of a century now, a career, what is it, do you think, though, about the skills agenda that you've inherited, that it doesn't matter actually how far back you go in recent history to Labour and Conservative governments, that we've never quite yet shifted the dial on overall skills performance in our economy? You know, productivity has lagged our international competitors. In fact, since the financial crash, productivity has only improved by a miserly 0.3%. So it's not a lot to write home about compared to our biggest international competitors. Why do you think government has just failed to shift the dial?
Well, I think that this is a sort of classic, highly complex question, I'll inevitably give an oversimplistic answer to.
Right.
But what's something I would draw attention to within huge sort of array of reasons for what you describe is the fact that for a long time, business in this country, employers in this country, could rely on a very large recruitment field, to bring in skilled and semi-skilled labour from abroad, and whilst we were part of the EU. And one of the really interesting things that I've discovered in the months since I've been skills minister is you visit colleges in some part of the country now where they say, for years, employers have not been coming to us asking for help with their skills pipeline. Mm-hmm. They are now. Mm. And that's just a very encouraging sign for me that we're starting to rewire the economy in the interests of local people. Mm. And the dream for me is that as we move forward, out of the pandemic and hopefully out of the economic shock waves that are coming from terrible events in Ukraine, but also the after effects of the pandemic, is that we start to have a world in which employers working with local skills providers start to make sure that local people can take advantage of the opportunities in their area and become part of the story of prosperity for their area. Mm. Because that's, for me, that's levelling up.
Sure. And I will move on to some of the solutions, but I just want to before we just leave the history bit behind, because looking back over the last sort of 3.5 decades, the only big skills target, if you want to call it that, that this department has delivered on is actually, and it succeeded on, is the higher education target. Every single target for skills performance increases, whether you go back to the Leach Review in 2006 or even further back than that, you read these documents, which are quite grand visions about in the next 10 years we will be world class in this, the next 20 years we will have leapfrogged probably Germany, depending on which report you read. What is it about our sort of system of government working with business? You mentioned their employers and switching off the tap of cheap labour from the European Union. There is something, isn't there, about the DNA and the culture within British business that perhaps isn't quite firing in partnership with localities and with government in perhaps the way it should be. I mean, training has halved since 2010 in terms of employer investment in skills. What can the government do about that?
So I think things are changing now, and I think that's partially due to Brexit, but it's also due to the fact that the government has this huge focus on Build Back Better, a huge amount of investment in construction, both physical but also digital infrastructure and so on, which means that there is a real demand for skills labour now, and you know, employers have to find that from somewhere, and they've hopefully they will find it locally. So a lot of the work that you know I'm doing, the Secretary of State is doing now, is to build on this idea, this long-standing idea now that we want to have a more employer-led system.
Sure.
And now where you add an employer-led system in put it in partnership with good local government and our excellent skills providers, you've got a really interesting mix. And the most inspiring things I've seen since I took over this job have been in places like Teesside, where you've got BP setting up its new hydrogen works. They're doing that in the Freeport, so the government, national government, has created the jurisdiction for the Freeport. The local council has set aside land in the Freeport for BP to do its work on, and BP is working with local providers in order to make sure that local young people are going to get the skills to work there, and that's fantastic.
It is fantastic.
It's really, really interesting.
And not just joined up thinking, but actually joined up doing in that particular example,
exactly.
Because you've got all parts of government and business working together.
You're listening to the Skills World Live radio show with Tom Buick.
OneFile is the best apprenticeship e-portfolio in the world. But did you know it's ideal for all kinds of vocational training, including traineeships? OneFile is very flexible, so it has everything you need to deliver, manage, and track traineeship progress.
We're currently using OneFile for all our traineeship learners. They love it, and so do we. It's fabulous. Thank you, OneFile.
To find out more about OneFile, head to onefile.co.uk and book a demo with a member of the team.
I want to come on now, Minister, to apprenticeships. Again, this is a big part of your brief. You've already been out and about, I think, very passionately talking about the need to drive up both the quantity and the quality of apprenticeships. In fact, you've issued your strategic guidance recently to the Institute for Apprenticeships and Technical Education, where you've asked them in particular to focus on young people. And this November, of course, we'll be at the 10th anniversary, I think, of the Richard Review, which was a review under your government, and it essentially, government accepted all the recommendations, but it certainly said if these recommendations were implemented, there would be both higher quantity, volume, starts, and quality. Here we are, fast forward 10 years, and we have less apprenticeships, fewer apprenticeships on programme now than we did in 2010. The National Audit Office says that the new standards regime costs twice as much as the old frameworks regime, but actually has delivered less in terms of when you look at these withdrawal rates. I mean, it's a mixed picture, isn't it? And does that concern you as Minister 8 months into the job? Appreciate you've inherited this role, but what sort of keeps you awake at night about English apprenticeships?
Well, obviously we did go through a major change programme. Rightly, we went through that change programme following the Richard Review. And, you know, remind your listeners, you know, one of the findings of that review was that there were a lot of people on apprenticeships who did not know that they were apprentices. You know, that's how watered down the system had become.
And the term wasn't protected legally.
That's
the government
right.
Moved
and,
on.
Yeah, and so we had to create, the government had to create a focus on quality, because the first thing is to make sure that employers really believe in the value of these things, because if they don't, we're all just wasting our time. Mm. And what you have to have are standards that have been agreed with employers, a proper way of doing things so that young people or people of any age can properly learn and earn whilst they're on the job, and they will have something that is going to be meaningful in their career going forward. Mm. We've done that now, and in moving over to standards, what we're seeing year on year since reform is more and more people doing an apprenticeship on these new standards. That figure is going to keep going up in every year of this parliament. I think we can go further. I'd like us to go even further, but I don't want I particularly don't want young people and SMEs, small and medium sized enterprises, to be forgotten as we as we push forward with this.
Because I thought for a moment there, Minister, you were going to put a clear stake in the ground on where you think the apprenticeship numbers will be by the end of this parliament. I mean, are you prepared to, for example, commit to a level above the benchmark of 2010? Will we see programme starts go up from the current 713,000 to closer to nearly a million where you would expect them to be by the end of this Parliament?
Figures will keep rising in each year of this Parliament. We got a good settlement in the spending review in the autumn. Chancellor gave us the best deal for skills that we've had in 10 years. Obviously, it's still not a limitless budget. We can't do. We can't go beyond that budget. But we're going to see more and more apprentices. But the thing I'm very. There are a number of aspects of apprenticeships that really interest me and excite me. And the thing that keeps me awake at night is making sure that we can sort of realise that potential. I think for a long time, post 18. The post-18 understanding of things in this country has been about are you going into university or are you going into work, and it's something that was probably when you were working here, Tom. That's kind of one of the things that was on the agenda.
Yeah, there was a big focus on that.
And and actually, I think that there is a third option that is opening up, which is the apprenticeship route. And so when we shouldn't just be talking about is it university or work. We should be talking about there's the middle option, which is where you can earn and learn at the same time. And we did, UCAS did some very interesting research for us with all of the young people who were creating UCAS accounts, about 750,000 of them. Mm. And this year they said, they asked the question, if there was an apprenticeship available, would you be interested in it? Nearly half of the people who were filling out a form said that they would be interested.
You're listening to the Skills World live radio show. Great music from the 80s, 90s and 2000s. Time now for the One File Tune of the Week. Listening to the Skills World Live radio show with Tom Buick.
And so there is an appetite there, and I'm really interested in how we can harness that.
And look, I mean, I do think it is one of the great innovations of the English apprenticeship system that we've smashed that glass ceiling that we have, for example, these degree level apprenticeships. I mean, even compared to Germany and some of the so-called world-class systems, we have this all-age, all-level system. I suppose the challenge as ever in policy is the government happy with the current balance where you've got, for example, 2/3 of the apprentices are over the age of 25 as opposed to 1/3 under the age of 25. Youth unemployment's still relatively high, 11%. It's 5.4% in Germany. So it's work in progress. We've got more work to do. But again, at the end of this parliament, would you expect to see, even if we don't get rid of the all-age, all-level system, the balance swinging back in favour of younger people or not?
So, I'm interested in driving up starts for young people. I don't, however, want to get us into a position where we're starting to talk down the significance of apprenticeships for people who are at a slightly later stage in their lives and careers, because I met so many people over the past few months who use apprenticeships either to coming back into the workplace after they've had children, or they've gone through a period of unemployment, or they want to change job, or even they want to boost their skills. Now, the majority of our 2030 workforce is, as you know, Tom, already in the workplace.
Yeah.
And if we want to upskill that workforce, there are a number of things we can do. Apprenticeships is definitely a part of it. We have our fantastic boot camps that are really starting to deliver. We've got the LLE that my colleague Michelle Donlan is spearheading.
And of course, you've got T-levels and broader qualifications reform. And it would be remiss of me, given my day job at the Federation of Awarding Bodies, not to then try and wrap up this interview by just talking about the qualifications reform programme. And maybe this is perhaps some reference back to the formation of the English state, which arguably has been one of over 1,000 years of a journey of steady centralisation of the English state.
I've got to interrupt you there, Tom. Absolutely not. The state was heavily centralised in the 10th century.
Well, I stand corrected. Right. But I suppose just to fast forward to the modern day, I mean, as a Conservative minister, are you comfortable with the notion of state monopolies growing up in the area of qualifications? T-levels are owned by the government. They're not owned by awarding organisations. Obviously, they're critical, those awarding organisations, to the success of T-levels, and they're very focused and involved in developing the world-class content, as you call it. Are you comfortable with the idea of the state owning these things and essentially driving the reform from here in this building, as opposed to looking at more historically where we've been, certainly since the 1870 Balfour Act, that mixed economy, that partnership between the state and independent charities in most cases, these examination boards and others?
Yeah, look, I've read your articles about this, and we talked about it a bit when I did my speech at Policy Exchange the other month. It was very clear from the Wolf reviews and the Sainsbury reviews that Wolf and Sainsbury review that something needed to be done, and we've set about doing that. And what we now have is a new series of qualifications at level 3 that have been co-designed with employers, 250, which is a lot. Before
it's
you say
0.0045%.
I know, but they
were
representative of their industry, and you don't when you do polls, you only poll 1,000 people ordinarily out of the country. But what we are facilitating is a greater voice for the employer within the system, and we're doing that in our level 3 review. We've done that through our level 3 review, we're doing it through our level 2 review, and we're doing it through the Skills Act, which is going to give a much bigger voice to employers in local areas who will get to draw up local skills improvement plans and set priorities with local providers to make sure that students and their parents and the government, everybody can be reassured that when a young person takes a qualification, it is being designed with an employer to help them get the skills the economy needs. And when they're choosing which course to take, they've got a reasonable degree of assurance that it's matching the needs of the local economy. And then the third thing that we're doing that, you know, I'm sort of set up with the Secretary of State's blessing since September, is the Unit for Future Skills. And what's that? What that's going to do is give much better data to users on what happened to people like them who did the courses they're thinking about, not just in terms of earnings, but where they went to work, what careers mm-hmm. they built. And I think that will be a fascinating insight into how effective are apprenticeships mm-hmm. operating in particular sectors in your area? You know, what are good, some good level 4 and 5 courses that are perhaps underutilized? All of these things will put at people's disposal some of the great data we've got across government.
Absolutely.
And open up a discussion that we haven't been able to have before.
Yeah, and I know there are many people in the sector who I work with on a day-to-day basis who will really welcome that greater transparency, that data, because you can't really have a meaningful conversation, I suppose, about the performance of the skills system without understanding what's going on. Minister Burghardt, responsible for skills and apprenticeships here at the Department for Education, thank you so much for being so generous with your time today and appearing on Skills World Live.
Thanks for having me, John.
You're listening to the Skills World Live radio show with Tom Buick.
So, you've heard now from the Minister. Let's go over to my interview with his opposite number in the House of Commons, Toby Perkins MP. I spoke to him down the line earlier, and I started by asking him, where does Labour go next, now that the Conservative government has enacted its own skills legislation?
Well, I think, overall, there's elements of this that can be built on. Local skills improvement plans, we think, may have some real value, but the way that they're currently envisaged, I think we believe will be far too narrow. So I could imagine an expansion of those. I think the huge missed opportunity of the skills bill was that it failed to address apprenticeships at all. And we continue to believe that apprenticeships are very much the gold standard in terms of skills policy and should be absolutely at the heart of skills strategy. And so, reform and review of the apprenticeship levy I think is a crucial element of that, and that's certainly something Labour will be looking to do. And then further development of the work experience and careers guidance elements, which again we see as really crucial at supporting people, particularly young people from more deprived communities, to access a wider panoply of options in their careers.
Yeah. Let's zone in then on the issue of apprenticeship reform, not least connecting it to opportunities for young people. I mean, the figures speak for themselves, and the government has to recognise this, that starts for young people are at their lowest level since before 2010. We've seen a 44% reduction in the number of opportunities for the under 24s. Of course, the Institute for Apprenticeships and Technical Education would point out that employers via the levy have gone for existing employees to skill them up. They've particularly gone for the so-called higher level skills. Management skills has been one of the areas where we've seen huge numbers of additional starts. So it's a mixed picture, but there is something, isn't there, Shadow Minister, about the balance really of the English apprenticeship system. Have we got that right?
No, I mean, absolutely we haven't. I mean, I think that the dearth of opportunities for sort of 16 to 19 year olds, particularly 16 to 24 year olds more generally, is really acute and is a huge problem. I think there needs to be a far greater focus on apprenticeships as a route into new careers, particularly in the context of Brexit. You know, you've got to remember that the fall that we've seen in the numbers of apprenticeships coming at exactly the time when the amount of European labour is actually reducing. So, the need is more acute than ever. And I think we've got an incredibly complicated and convoluted picture for employers at the moment. You know, they're being asked to offer T-level work experience, being asked to offer work experience from school, they're being asked to do apprenticeships, traineeships. And I think there's many employers that I speak to that just feel absolutely overwhelmed by it all. Wonder when they're meant to actually spend some time getting on with some work. And I think the whole system is failing right now. There's absolutely a need to continue training managerial staff. But I don't think that that's what the apprenticeship levy should be about. There is absolutely a need to support people who are older in life to retrain in new careers, and I support that entirely. But it's particularly that 16 to 24 cohort who are being left out at the moment. And I think the government are strategically failing them very badly.
Yeah, I mean, there's a report recently that came out by one of the think tanks, EDSK, looking at the number of not in education, employment and training. Again, we haven't shifted the dial on that in over 20 years. So under successive governments, you know, we've got 700,000 young people who are not in any form of productive education, training, skills training or apprenticeship. And it's ironic listening to you in terms of talking about the confusion of employers, because that's also in many ways part of the government's narrative. But I think what you're saying is that where we've kind of arrived at the moment, we're not necessarily cutting down on that confusion. And I guess here what you're alluding to is the fact, as you say, we've got these new qualifications, T-levels. We'll see the first cohort graduate this summer. So it'd be interesting to see where those less than 2,000 students progress onto in the system. I think those of us in the sector will be looking very closely at the extent to which government delivers on the promise that the majority go into skilled employment. That will be one to watch. But I think other seasoned observers and experts in the sector, and I know this is something you've raised on the front bench in the House of Commons, is that sense of what's the vision for T-levels? Where's the connect between these study programmes at further education colleges like the ones in your constituency out through to the apprenticeship system so that, in a sense, there's somewhere for these students to go. And it's not just the default position, arguably, of going to university. Not, there's nothing wrong with that. But, we don't want to kind of fall back into that default position, do we?
No, we absolutely don't. And T-levels are supposed to be the answer to that. I have to say, T-level students that I've met, by and large, are expecting to come off their T-level and go towards university. Not uniquely, and some courses more than others. But by and large, those that I've met are seeing T-levels as a route towards university. As I say, I think that it's not that things have failed to change over the course of the last 12 years. It's that the picture's got increasingly muddled. I think that under the Labour government, you had apprenticeships, which was a real priority. You had Train to Gain, which was aimed at those already employed who were looking to expand their skills.
Particularly at level two, wasn't it? Yeah.
We scratched that Train to Gain into apprenticeships to massively bolster the numbers. And then as time has gone on, we've got this situation where apprenticeships have become muddled. There was a time where they were promoting traineeships because of the level of youth unemployment. And you've got businesses, I think, who were sort of selling them as a try before you buy. You can have someone for 6 weeks before you have to actually pay them. And I think that undermined the whole traineeship program. And as I say, then they invented T-levels, which were supposed to be very vocationally focused. But now we're seeing people who are studying those going towards university rather than necessarily the workplace. So I think the picture's muddled. I think a future Labour government would say apprenticeships are absolutely the priority here. We think there is a role for T-levels. We think that there needs to be a little more humility from government about a qualification that's still very much evolving. And recognise that we don't know where it's going to end up. And in 3 or 4 years' time, it quite possibly won't look like it does today. So let's not kill things that do work on the altar of trying to preserve and enhance the number of people doing T-levels. But let's overall see apprenticeships and that long-term commitment by an employer in a member of staff and the skills that they're going to develop as the key way that businesses can contribute to generating the next generation.
Yeah, I agree with you. There's definitely the danger if we're not careful with these reforms. Whilst obviously the sector as a whole is very supportive of the direction of travel, I think we've got to cut down on some of the hubris, actually, if we're not careful, making very, very grand promises about essentially untried, untested programmes. Looking ahead then to the next general election, who knows when that will be. The Fixed Term Parliament Act, of course, has now been scrapped. I did check this earlier. Apparently, legally, Parliament will automatically dissolve on Tuesday, the 17th of December, 2024. That takes us actually just a bit beyond the deadline that government has set for switching off funding for qualifications, particularly those that overlap with the new T-levels. Of course, there's a broader qualifications reform programme, not least at level two and below. You know, there are some sector watchers there absolutely horrified about the impact assessment the government wrote, which looked at potentially 70% of level two and below qualifications disappearing from the landscape. Of course, it's unlikely, I think, that this government will go for another winter election. You probably remember it fondly, traipsing around your constituency looking for votes during the middle of winter. So, you know, we're probably looking at spring 2024 at the latest. If Labour was elected at that point, would you call off a lot of these big decisions around defunding and have a good old review and look at where you go next?
Well, I think we'd certainly want to see what the evidence was, yes. I mean, I think we're already sort of starting that process now. It's interesting that the level three qualifications the government are proposing to defund now is around 10%, I think, of all of the level three courses studied.
This is in the first two waves, yeah, that's
yeah.
right. So I
think, now, so you know, if you, 10, if you think about the sort of rhetoric we were hearing from government maybe 9 months ago, which was suggesting that BTECs were a failing qualification and that T-levels were going to replace them basically across the board. To get from that sort of talk to now maybe getting rid of 10%, I think suggests that when government have actually looked at the detail, they have limited their ambitions hugely. But even within that, I think there are employers that are saying they're pretty concerned, particularly around things like construction, about whether the proposed T-level qualification replacing the BTEC is going to be the right kind of approach. And so we are going to want to review what happens. At the same time, you know, what we don't want to do is just have another sort of 2 or 3 years of atrophy. We think that there's been sort of maybe far too much focus on qualifications and maybe not enough focus on outcomes, actually. You know, I think that, yes, there will need to be a review. I think there will also, you know, need to be a real sense of momentum.
Yeah. Just finally then, in the time we've got available, because I did on the programme earlier interview Minister Burghardt, and he was very confident that the government's on the right tracks, as you might expect, that they're putting huge investment into the skills unit centrally. They've announced over £20 million that are going to go into these local skills improvement plans. We've seen eight of those already that have come up from the pilot areas. Meanwhile, you know, we've got one part of government saying it's potentially going to cut the size of the civil service over the next few years by a fifth, is what's been reported in the press as to what the Prime Minister has asked for. Meanwhile, we've seen Ofqual's budget increased by £1.4 million a year up to the end of this spending review period. IFATE's headcount has quadrupled. And of course, you know, millions of pounds now are going to go into these local skills improvement plans. Again, from a Labour point of view, do you see that as good value for money?
Well, I'm very anxious about the way that local skills improvement plans are currently being developed. We are obviously at an early stage, but I think in terms of what we've seen so far, I'm not convinced that there's been a huge amount of value coming out of that. I mean, I think that the sort of amounts of money that we're talking about, if they were making a radical difference and a positive difference, then that would be good. But I'm not convinced that in terms of the approach that's currently being taken, because everything we've seen under this government has all been targeted on putting employers in the driving seat. I mean, that was what we were hearing about the original apprenticeship reforms. That's what we're hearing about the introduction of the apprenticeship levy. That's what we were hearing from ministers from John Hayes through Nick Bowles. And you can probably remember them all better than I can. But they all claimed to be introducing reforms that were going to deliver the same thing, apprenticeships, employers in the driving seat. And actually, my experience is that employers want a seat at the table. They don't want to become the educators themselves. They've got businesses to run. What they want to do is make sure their voice is heard. And I, you know, as I say, in term, we'll see what comes out of this. But, you know, what I've seen so far, which is that the LSIPs are almost an outsourcing of policy rather than outsourcing of service delivery, which we used to under this government, is not an approach that I have a huge amount of confidence in.
Okay. Toby Perkins, MP,
Shadow Minister for Skills and Further Education. Thanks for joining Skills World Live today.
You're listening to the Skills World Live radio show with Tom Buick.
That's all we've got time for on the podcast today. I hope you found those interviews with our two politicians enlightening. And if not, well, the show will be back in its usual format with me talking to another super informed panel of guests. Remember, if you want to be on the show, then just email us at skillsworld@fenews.co.uk. We're taking a short break now for the half term, but do look out for details of the upcoming episodes, including our long-awaited live college roadshow sponsored by Pearson BTEC and Apprenticeships. These are the programmes where we plan to showcase the creative and technical skills of Level 3 Applied General Studies students who will be helping us to co-produce each episode in front of a live studio audience. So enjoy the late spring sunshine, everyone, and I'll see you again very soon. Goodbye.
Remember to subscribe to Skills World Live at fenews.co.uk or just download the show from any one of your favourite podcasting sites, including iTunes, Spotify and Spreaker. Your world, Skills World.